ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending men's greetings and salutations upon the final Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us tawfiq and ability to begin this journey and to complete this journey, and talking about the most important ilm, ilm ma yanfa'u an-nas fi dunya wa fi al-akhirah, the most important knowledge that benefits the individual upon this dunya firstly, and even more so inside the akhirah. That is the knowledge, ilm al-tawheed, the oneness, the recognition, and the ubudiyah, the worship, sincerely and solely, strictly for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I intend over these next few weeks, bi'iznillahi ta'ala, just to set some house or some ground rules, basically just go through the discussion, some 45 minutes or so, then to take some corrections or comments for 10 to 15 minutes. Obviously, first we need to understand whatever we read and we go through, we explain. It is not my intent, and hopefully I hope not anybody's intent, to begin to apply these words upon any individual. Some people in their zest and in their zeal begin to say so-and-so is a mushrik, so-and-so is a polytheist, so-and-so is a kafir, so-and-so is a fasiq, so-and-so is like this. So that is not my intent in this study, to begin to take these rulings or these regulations or these explanations to begin to apply them as general people, to apply them upon other fellow Muslim brothers and sisters. Also, we intend that the questions remain, and inshallah, according to the topic and appropriate to the topic. Anybody who has any personal concerns, especially our respected sisters, tend to forward their personal concerns and their problems and the issues that they have. The masjid has a separate section. They can speak to the imams, the masjid, or present them to the office, and they will deal with those personal concerns. We are not here to deal with marital issues and personal matters that people have inside their life. We are here to explain a general explanation of the knowledge of Tawheed that will benefit us in this dunya, inshallah. Obviously, there's many books which are available, Kitab al-Tawheed, and many shuruhat, many explanations that exist out there. Those who are familiar with Arabic language will have come across many in the explanation and many books. And from my small experience, some of these explanations, some of these books, you do find some element of hardship in trying to understand the ibarat and the usloob, or sometimes to be written by many of these respectable mashaykh. That's not to criticize them, it's what the deficiency lies upon us, and the lack of our understanding of the Arabic language and comprehension, and sometimes you find that the way they've depicted or written certain things becomes difficult for us to understand. So we find that many of the contemporary ulama begin to try to write with a more usloob, which is sahal, which is easy, that every individual can understand. Even the Arabs themselves begin to find more comfort in reading some of these works. Thus, in general, if you look at the works of Shaykh Uthaymeen rahmatullah alayhi, his many shuruhat, you find it's possibly the most easiest one to understand, and the way that he presents himself in explanation of Tawheed, etc., and Aqa'id, you find it's very, very beneficial for the individual, and likewise to get his recordings to follow that as well. The text that we've chosen as well, even though unfortunately I think it may have been advertised as Kitab al-Tawheed of Shaykh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, decided to go for the explanation of Shaykh Dr. Salih Al-Fawzan. Primarily because if you look at his explanation, what he's done, he's taken the mulakhas, the summary of all the main themes, and he's presented it in his own explanation with a very easy understanding. As I mentioned, you go back to even Sheikh Abdul Wahhab's textbook and look at the explanation, at times you begin to find a very technical, deep depiction of certain things, which sometimes doesn't concern every single individual. So So the Sheikh then here began to extract most of the beneficial topics that concern us, and he compiled them and explained them in an easy manner. So it becomes easy for all of us, inshallah, to understand. So most of the works of Ibn Taymiyyah, of Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, وَأَمْثَالُمْ كَثِيرًا Sheikh Al-Fayyid al-Mulakka summarized their works and put them together. We find that the reason for teaching and for studying this, that we find the many reasons we mentioned, the ulama, as we began with, al-ilm al-asasi, the most important knowledge that concerns every single Muslim is the knowledge of the belief towards and regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, we find the essence of any da'wah, any movement, is based upon the belief towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Especially today that we find many people focus on different elements, whether it be tazkiyah, or talk about iqtisad, economics, or we find about the Islamic system, etc. These are all beneficial and important things. But if any movement fails to comprehend that the real essence of the real movement of the Muslim is based upon the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a person fails to understand that, then all of these secondary issues or tertiary issues have no importance at all. Because if you begin to study the Quran in great detail, you find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has even mentioned those people who are given tamkeen al-ard, given dominance and priority in the earth, are those individuals that they begin to carry out that characteristic, يَعْبُدُونَنِي وَلَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا. They begin to worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and associate no partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the way that the individual is given strength and dominance and power upon the earth of being people of Ahlul Tawheed, of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the pristine and the most orthodox manner. Second reason, we mentioned that this is not a political agenda. Tawheed is not a political agenda, as some people may begin to think that it is a certain, whether you begin to find such, unfortunately, slogans which have a derogatory meaning of da'wah al-wahhabiyya or da'wah al-najdiyya. This is the da'wah of wahhabiyya or najdiyya or a da'wah of a certain regime or certain people, etc. No, this is not a political agenda. Those people who are sincere and want to follow the path of Ahlul Sunnah, you'll find that that is all that these ulama have been trying to do, is try to compile the most swiftest and the quickest way to find the best way to enter into paradise. But all of us at Ahlul Sunnah can conclude the whole pinnacle point of Tawheed is to be pardoned and to be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala via carrying out the right and appropriate actions upon basira, upon foresight and knowledge, that a person worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the right understanding, with the right mentality and the right format, so it becomes something which is accepted in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's the third element, to save us from the fire. A person trying to deliver themselves from the fire. Even Shaykh mentioned the hadith of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, that we find what is the right that the person can claim from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though no one has a right to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that manner. But just paraphrasing the hadith, as we find, is the person can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive and to pardon that individual. Why? Because they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with total sincerity and associated no partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another key word that we find that will prop up many times are what's known as firqatun najiyah, the saved sect, al-ta'ifatun mansura, the victorious group, all these synonymous terms that you'll find, that people begin to throw them around and maybe attribute them to themselves or to other individuals. And if you read the works of Ibn Taymiyyah, you find something very, very remarkable. If you look at the end of his Aqidatul Wasatiyah, you find that he writes himself, and no two scholars of Ahlul Sunnah will differ about his credentials of being Shaykh al-Islam. Ignore the people who have hatred towards him, but no two scholars of Ahlul Sunnah will differ about his rank and his prestige regarding Islam. He even writes in the end of his works himself that I aspire and I hope to be amongst the people in the saved group. I aspire to be amongst the victorious saved sect. So imagine, this is Shaykh himself who spent most of his life writing about Aqa'id of Ahlul Sunnah, is still humbling himself and saying, I aspire to be amongst those individuals. And we begin to take these symbols and these slogans very lightly and begin to portray that we are firqatun najiyah, we are the saved sect, we are the victorious group, etc. فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَعْلَمُوا لِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Don't claim sanctity and purity for yourself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the people who are the pious and the individuals. So likewise, we find that the fourth thing we find, if we don't know about Tawheed, then we have to begin to read the works. Especially once a person begins to study the Arabic language, you find, as I mentioned, many, many shuruhat, many, many books that it would take a person's lifetime and beyond that to really comprehend and understand al-Tawheed. Obviously, in the English language, only have a few books which are available, so that's for some of us, it may become a, excuse the expression, academic subject, a boring subject, something which is too technical. But if you begin to read in Arabic language, you find that it is a remarkable subject. Even what comes to mind at the moment in the reading of Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah's Al-Nuniyah that you find, his Qasa'id, his Qasida, all based in the Harf Nun, that you find thousands of lines of poetry. Thousands of lines of poetry talk about the creed of Ahl Sunnah. And if you begin to study, you find it's truly remarkable, his efforts and the way he's tried to compile it, help us to understand. And there's many shuruhat that you find have been written of his qasida that you find. Sheikh Saleh Fawzan has 3 volumes himself. Sheikh Muhammad Khalil Harras has written it as well. Another Sheikh has well written many explanations of these qasa'id, these qasida, or these lines and your poetry that will benefit the individual. Likewise, he touched from Sheikh Muhammad bin Saleh Uthaymeen. Many of his works that you find, many books that he's written, explanation of Kitab al-Tawheed, al-Wasatiyah that we find, and other works as well, which benefit the individual. When a person begins to read, you find it becomes an immense innate knowledge. And as we heard, the whole intent is to make the individual to become one who worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon more foresightness and more any understanding towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another reason why a person studies Tawheed is obviously that there could be various attacks against any this da'wah or against any Islam. So the person needs to see where people have deviated away. Sometimes that deviancy is extreme, sometimes that deviancy is only minute. So that's another reason why a person is studying ilm al-tawheed, to begin to understand that how some individuals or some groups or some methodologies have deviated away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as I mentioned, it's not for us to then go and to apply this upon people openly in this manner. Likewise, find what's known as people who go into a concept of the tasawwuf, of people who go into a concept of monastic living that we find, or people who begin to worship the graves and other elements that begin to stray away. So many of the ulama, they wrote these works with the intent to help guide the people by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to help them return back to the right, the orthodox belief in the path and the methodology laid out by the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, explained by his companions. We find inside the Quran, فَإِنْ آمَنُوا بِمِثْلِ مَا آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ فَقَدْ اِهْتَدَوْا. If you believe as they believe, then you will be rightly guided like those individuals who came before us. So the first thing that we find is al-inhiraf fi hayat al-bashariya. You find that unfortunately that the human being, mankind, begins to go away from the essence of worship towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the ulama mentioned, the essence of a human being is he is a muwahid. He is one who worships only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unlike you find that Orientalists and other individuals, they tend to write that a human being was worship many deities, worship many idols, he was idolatrous in nature, and then he found the one God. This is incorrect. The essence of Islam is that man, human being, the ummah, the nation, has been a nation of worshipping only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then people, they began to deviate away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we find inside the Quran, in Surah Al-Thariyah, that we find, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I did not create the jinn and the human being except for to worship me. In another qira'ah that you find, if I'm not mistaken, Ibn Abbas, بِمَعْنَى لِيُوَحِّدُونَ. To single out only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for worship. So mankind has been created for that sole purpose, for the recognition and to worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and associate no partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ما أريد منهم من رزق وما أريد أن يطعمون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want any rizq, any sustenance, any benefit from us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that feeds and nourishes us. That's the general meaning of Rabb, is the nourisher, the provider, the sustainer, the one who takes care. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that provides. He does not need any sustenance, and he does not need to take any sustenance from the human beings. إِنَّ اللَّهُ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. He is the one who is a razzaq, the one who provides the provision, who gives sustenance, and he is the one subhanahu wa ta'ala, full of strength, and power. So you find that the essence of tawheed, of the human being, is what the Quran begins to deliver, which talks about the natural fitrah, the natural disposition of a human being is to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As you find in many of works of tafsir, talking about the ayat in Surah Al-A'raf, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took from the loins of Bani Adam, brought them all in front and made them all testify, أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ, and said, am I not your Lord? And all of us in the affirmative said, yes, you are our Lord. Lest we say on the Day of Judgment, إِنَّا كُنَّ عَنْ هَذَا غَافِلِينَ. Lest we may come and try to make an excuse on the Day of Judgment that we were heedless, we were unaware that we have to worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we find that the human being has been programmed, as they say, by nature, to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that inhiraf, that going away from the path, as we're going to mention, the coming of shaitan and the various concepts begin to take the individual away from the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَأَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا. And if aqim, stand and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, dedicate your face and your worship towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with total worship. فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا لَا تَبْدِيلَ لِخَلْقِ اللَّهِ. Inside Surah Al-Rum that we find the 30th Surah Al-Quran, ayah number 30 as well that we find. And this is the natural disposition that the human being has been created upon, to worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَا تَبْدِيلَ لِخَلْقِ اللَّهِ. There's no change in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a human being that changes and goes away from that. Likewise in the hadith that we find, كُلُّ مَوْجُودْ يُولُدْ عَلَى الْفِطْرَةِ. Every single child is born upon the natural disposition. Every single child is a Muslim. But the parents come and make the child, whether to become a Jew or a Christian, or a fire worshipper, or Magian that we find, Majus that we find. So it's the parents that have the influence, or the bi'ah, the environment, which has a big influence of taking an individual from an orthodox belief, an orthodox life, to a life of corruption, a life of being shirk, associating partners towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we find, فَالْأَصْلُ فِي بَنِي آدَمْ التَّوْحِيدِ. The essence in the children of Adam is التَّوْحِيدِ, the recognition and the belief and the affirmation towards the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we find that كَانَ النَّاسُ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا. People, you need nations, people were one nation. فَبَعَثَ اللَّهُ النَّبِيِّينَ مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the messengers and the prophets to give the glad tidings and to warn any people that you find inside in Surah Al-Baqarah, second chapter of Quran, verse 213. So we find that أول ما حدث الشرك والانحراف عن العقيدة الصحيحة, the first time that you find that people began to go away from the correct belief towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was in the time of قوم نوح, time of Nuh alayhi salam. You find that people began to began to drift away. Nuh alayhi salam is classified in his aside point as the first messenger. Obviously, that we know that Adam alayhi salam is classified as the first Nabi, as the first prophet, but the first actual messenger who came to then deliver the message to the people is Nuh alayhi salam. Inna uhayna ilayka kama uhayna ila Nuh wa nabiyina min ba'dihi. Indeed, we gave you revelation like we gave to Nuh alayhi salam before you, that wa nabiyina min ba'dihi, and the prophets that came in after him. So here we find the ulama used this ayah as an evidence from Surah An-Nisa, the fourth chapter of the Quran, verse 163, that the first messenger that was sent down and upon the people was none other than Nuh alayhi salam. Thus Ibn Abbas mentioned, كَانَ بَيْنَ آدَمْ وَنُوحَ عَلَيْهِمَ السَّلَامُ عَشْرَةُ قُرُونَ. Between Adam alayhi salam and Nuh alayhi salam, there was some 10 centuries. كُلُّهُمْ عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ. All of them were upon al-Islam. قال ابن قيم, and he mentioned in one of his works, وَهَذَا الْقَوْلُ هُوَ الصَّوَابُ قَطْعًا. This is the true statement that people in the beginning were upon the oneness and the worship and the devotion towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you find in a قِرَعَ فُبَيْ بِنْ كَعَبْ, يعني في آية البقرة, فَاخْتَلَفُوا فَبَعَثَ اللَّهُ النَّبِيِّينَ. Whereas the original item mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there was, كَانَ النَّاسُ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا فَبَعَثَ اللَّهُ النَّبِيِّينَ. You find that the ummah was one nation. But here you find this qira'ah that Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah mentioned, that فَاخْتَلَفُوا, because people differed, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then sent the messenger and the prophets to give them glad tidings and to warn them. So people deviated from the path. So one reason of sending the messenger and the prophets was to remind them that the whole intent of worship is to worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'm going to come to a later stage, you read the ayat inside Surah Nuh itself, either 70th or the 71st chapter of the Quran, when memory serves the greatest stage. You find in there, you find the final ayat begin to talk about how these people began to deviate, and these statues they erected of the pious people that used to respect and show any reverence towards them, and later nation began to actually worship any of these individuals. وَمَا كَانَ النَّاسُ إِلَّا أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا فَاخْتَلَفُوا. So the people, the ummah was one nation, then they began to differ, بِمَعْنَ, began to go towards the path of shirk. So thus many of the ulama begin to mention that the first individual who began in the Arabs began to insert the concept of associating partners towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the coming of idolatry and bringing of an asnam, bringing of statues and idols, etc., was this individual, Amr ibn Luhay al-Khuza'i. was the first individual in the Arabs. They didn't really know these practices. He's the one that began to insert this practice of extra reverence and idolatry and idol worshiping, etc. And thus you can begin to find that even in the land of Arabia, it went to a low point in history, that you find that graves became rampant there, and people began to commit shirk openly, and began to do many, many incorrect practices, and people began to enter into the path of finding intermediaries to get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sacrificing on the graves, going through the path of the salihin, the righteous people, which exist even today, unfortunately. And some of these people try to hide behind the disguise, what's wrong with the salihin, what's wrong with the righteous people, etc. We don't have any contention with righteous people and pious people, etc. The contention lies is whereby a person tries to use them as an intermediary to come towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once they've left this dunya. We're not discussing here about whilst they're living. We recognize the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَا اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. Indeed, the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no fear, no grief is upon them. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. Those who believe and are pious individuals. That's Ibn Taymiyyah mentioned that every single person who follows the path of taqwa becomes a wali of Allah, becomes a friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sticking to the halal and avoiding the haram. There's no special mantra or special wording, special things a person needs to do inside their life. A person follows the path of the Quran and Sunnah. Every individual, and he eventually becomes one who is close, and he qariban lillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala, close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their own way. So we find the people, Ahlul Shirk, they began to use exactly the same excuses. مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. We only worship them to make us come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what the mushrikun at the time of Quraysh used to give this justification. And unfortunately, you find this also today. People say, look, we don't physically worship these dead people, or we don't even think that they can benefit us, etc. We just find these as a way, as a wasila or wasail to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this argument mentions in the Quran that the Quraysh used exactly the same unique concept of trying to come through these form of intermediaries to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thus, how true is the Quran, how it begins to highlight that the bashar, masses of human beings, will begin to unfortunately begin to commit shirk. As the Quran mentions with the end of Surah Yusuf, وَمَا يُؤْمِنُوا أَكْثَرُهُمْ بِاللَّهِ إِلَّا وَهُمْ مُشْرِكُونَ. Most people believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but their creed, their belief is tainted with shirk. So obviously, once again, as I began with, don't take this and apply this to someone. If you see someone committing shirk or doing themselves, أَنْتَ مُشْرِكِ or مُشْرِكِ, etc. It's not for us. The person may have some genuine excuse, or there may be some misunderstanding. First, you have to give, you need a da'wah, you have to convey the message, you need to these individuals to the best ability. Obviously, where lands of Ahlul Tawheed and people of Tawheed are strong and dominant, they can openly say that these people, these people have deviated, these people are mushrikun, etc. Because obviously, they've done the hard work, the groundwork of laying out the message and towards their people and taking away any form of excuse. As for us today, that we know many of our family members in our culture, in our society, in our environment, that the effort has not been made. Rather, we find that our effort at times has been a very harsh, negative impact upon the people around us. That people are using our words against us. So we want people to come back to the path of Tawheed, the path of oneness, and a person has to have that interest of being worried about the people around them, worried about their subjects, and trying to rescue them from the fire of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not there to try to dismantle them and to use derogatory words towards them, to belittle them, etc. A person is trying to bring out the best of humanity to make them return back to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we find these individuals, unfortunately, that we find that some of these individuals, their belief has at times even become more corrupt than people like Fir'aun. Obviously, Fir'aun claimed to be a sovereign power, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى, etc. But he, at the end of the day, recognized that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that benefits and harms. As you find some of the ulama mentioned at the Quraysh, and they recognize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Rabb. But when it came to their ibadah, that is where they began to deviate. As for today, you find Muslims know that ibadah should be towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but then sometimes you find the concept of recognizing that benefit and harm and is allowed comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's where sometimes we begin to weaken. We begin to rely upon these other elements that we think that this harms or benefits us is clearly visible. Unfortunately, inside the Muslim ummah, unfortunately. What is the whole meaning of shirk? What does it mean? What does it entertain? What are the various forms of find the ulama have concluded or compiled or put together? So as we mentioned, the essence of the person is ibadah, is worship. So ibadah that we find is a complete, a word which is shamil, which is complete. So ibadah isn't just as what some of us may think, that pray, fasting. Ibadah is also umur al-qalbiyya, affairs of the heart, of al-hub, wal-khawf, wal-raja, love, hope, fear, that exists inside the heart of the individual. That is total ibadah. Everything of the individual is turning towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether it be the external element or the internal element, is total servitude and obedience towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is classified as a form of worship, and that worship is done, or that feeling, or that thought is done, trying to gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we find a shirk fi rububiyya is qaleel, inside the lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very minimal. But in the worship towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's where primarily it begins to take place. So these wal ghalib al ishraq fi uluhiyya. So you find in general, the most concept of shirk begins to take place when it comes to worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thus you find the actions like you find anwa' al ibadah kadhabhi, actions of ibadah, physical worship that you find of sacrifice, wal-nadhr, of making vows and oaths, wal-khawf, wal-raja, wal-mahabba. These are all elements of shirk. A person begins to fear an individual, hope and trust in an individual, etc. These are all elements of shirk, and one's ibadah towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So thus you find shirk a'adhumu dhunub. Thus you find that shirk is classified as the most grievous sin, the most wicked sin, or the most highest sin that a person can commit inside their life, is to associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what are the reasons why shirk has been classified as the most abominable and the most unforgivable sin that we find? Amongst the elements that we find, as Shaykh Saad al-Fawzan mentions, the person begins to make this resemblance between the creation and the creator. Person begins to make similarities between the creation and the creator by thinking that the creation shares some elements of power and whatever it may be, of forgiveness, of pardoning, of helping, etc. So we as Muslims need to conclude that the whole element of everything lies with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why shirk is classified as a form of oppression, of dhulm. And this dhulm doesn't affect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It affects the individual. That you find inside Surah Al-Qur'an, إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. And shirk is the most oppressive sin, the most oppressive harm an individual can do upon their own self. That's what shirk is described as, ظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. The gravest any oppression, the gravest sin. And thus we find that what is the meaning of ظُلْم? ظُلْم, remember I mentioned, is وَدْعُ شَيْءٍ فِي غَيْرْ مَوْضِعِهِ, to place something in an incorrect location. You place it not in the right location. Any form of doing something outside of its location is classified as oppression. So why is shirk classified as oppression? Because your ibadah, as you mentioned, is supposed to be placed in the right format and the right manner towards whom? Towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you don't begin to do that, it becomes dhulm. It becomes oppression upon your own self. You're actually affecting your own ibadah. That's why the opposite of al-hikmah. Al-hikmah is classified as wad'u shay' fi makanihi. Wisdom is classified as placing anything in its right place. So when a person does something appropriately, that is a concept, a sign in your wisdom. When they speak appropriately, when they worship appropriately, when they do something appropriately, they're doing it at the right time, at the right place, at the right moment, is a sign of wisdom. It is the inner meaning of wisdom. Likewise, but secondly, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has informed us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not forgive any sin, will forgive, sorry, every sin, except for shirk. If a person dies upon shirk, there's no forgiveness for that individual. And as you find in Surah An-Nisa, you find two unique occasions. The first part of the ayah is totally identical. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ وَيُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءَ. In Surah An-Nisa, the fourth chapter of the Qur'an, and that we find ayah number 48, and likewise again, ayah number 116. So twice inside the Qur'an, inside the same surah, the beginning section, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned exactly identical words. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive every single sin except for associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. if a person repents before they pass away, then there's inshallah forgiveness for that individual. As for the conclusion of the ayah, just to help us to understand the context of the ayah, end of Surah An-Nisa, verse 48, finishes by mentioning, وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّيْهِ فَقَدْ افْتَرَى إِثْمًا عَظِيمًا. Whoever associates partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has indeed invented an abominable lie, an attribute towards the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The end of verse 148 mentions, 116, sorry, وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّيْهِ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا. Whoever associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gone on a far away, a misguided path of loss, manifest loss. That person has drifted away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, you find another very powerful verse inside the Quran, inside Surah Al-Hajj, the 22nd chapter of the Quran. And you talk about Surah Al-Hajj, the whole general theme of the surah, if you really look at it in great detail, is nothing but tawheed. It's nothing but worship and oneness towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In there, you find an ayah, verse number 31. وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَكَأَنَّمَا خَرَّ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. Whoever commits shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَكَأَنَّمَا خَرَّ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ, is as if that individual has fallen from the heavens, fallen from the skies. فَتَخْطَفُهُ الطَّيْرُ أَوْ تَحْمِي بِهِ الرِّيحِ فِي مَكَانٍ سَحِيقٍ. Or as he's dropping, a bird snatches him, or the wind blows that individual away to a faraway destination, a location. What is the meaning of this ayah? What is the plausible meaning, as ulama tafsir have mentioned? One plausible meaning is, الشرك يعني يباعدك عن الله سبحانه وتعالى. Shirk takes you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shirk does not bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the general meaning of this ayah. It's as if the person is falling from the heavens, a bird snatches that individual, or the wind blows you away to what? A faraway destination location. So any element of shirk does not bring an individual closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, rather the opposite, the contrary, it drifts the individual further and further away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, you find shirk nullifies the action of the individual, especially the major shirk that we're going to mention. Any minor shirk, you can take away that good deed. But as for major shirk, it can nullify all the action of the individual, brings him to a standstill. That's why sometimes people, any quote where they mention that Mother Teresa was a good woman, or so and so, Gandhi was a good man, or this person was good like this. And many, mashallah, they may have done good things to help humanity, to help people in their efforts. But if you look at their aqa'id, you look at their belief, that even some Muslims fall into that trap. They say that, you know, this is a good person, etc. But if the person associates partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all those good deeds are wiped out. No matter what good deeds they may have done inside their life. So imagine, if that's for non-Muslims, then think about us Muslims, or those Muslims who have fallen into an element of major shirk. وَلَوْ أَشْرَكُوا لَحَبِطَ عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. If these people have committed shirk, لَحَبِطَ عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. We will nullify, we will wipe out the actions that they used to carry out inside their lives. Inside Surah Al-An'am, the 6th chapter of the Qur'an, verse number 88. Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ. And he revealed upon you, sent revelation upon you, وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ. And those who came before you, بِمَعْنَى الْأَنْبِيَا وَالرُّسُلْ. The messengers and the prophets that came before you, لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ. Even though this is mustahil, it's not possible to think this about the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam or any of the prophets. But this is from a form of a warning, of attribute of approach inside the Quran that we find. لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. We would cancel and wipe out your deeds, and you'll be amongst any losing any individuals inside Surah Zumar that we find verse number 65. Likewise, you find أَنَّ الْمُشْرِكْ حَلَالُ الدَّمُ وَالْمَالِ. The person who's classified as a Muslim, who's clear-cut, classified as committing shirk, and there's no doubt upon that, that person's wealth, property, blood, honor, sanctity becomes halal. As I mentioned, please don't go and try to apply this to any individuals. فَاقْتُلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ حَيْثُ وَجَدْتُمُوهُمْ وَخُذُوهُمْ وَاحْصُرُوهُمْ وَاقْعُدُوا لَهُمْ كُلَّ مَرْصَدٍ. Where we find, فَاقْتُلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Fight and strive against the mushrikeen wherever you find them. Before we jump on the bandwagon of this ayah that we find some people begin to highlight, the Surah Tawbah in the 9th chapter, verse number 5 that we find, this ayah refers to the people, the Muslim rulers, the people in authority and power. So sometimes people just begin to take ayahs of the Quran, فَاقْتُلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ. كون كيل يعني سلين المشركون. لا the ayat and the context, they have an application that can only be done from people who have that authority, who have that role, who have that authority and are able to enforce that law and legislation upon the people. Likewise, find the famous hadith, أُمِرْتُ أَنْ أُقَاتِلَ النَّاسِ حَتَّى يَقُولُوا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. I've been commanded, ordered to fight against the people until they worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they make that statement. فَإِذَا قَالُوهَا, they begin to say that, make that statement, they recognize the statement, then their wealth and their property and their blood become sanctified, except for the right of Islam that belongs to the person who refuses to pray, offer their prayers, give zakah, etc. So we find that the Muslim becomes any open to the punishment if they enter into carrying out shirk billahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, as we touched upon, that shirk is classified as the most major of sins. As you find Imam al-Dhahabi in his works on Kaba'ir, where he brings some 90 odd major sins. If you go and read the works, obviously some of the sins are quite clear and apparent, but some of them, you begin to read them, you find that maybe some of these actually do them on a daily basis. Like al-Ghiba that we find backbiting is min al-Kaba'ir, is classified amongst the major sins. Major sins. And obviously ulama have concluded, mentioned what classifies as a major sin, that whereby in the Quran it mentions adab or iqab, punishment, chastisement, torture, or a rule or regulation or hadith is implemented upon that individual that will carry out that sin, etc. These are all the general symbols that you find. And Imam al-Dhahabi in his works of Kaba'ir brings some 90 or 91 odd yearly major sins which have been highlighted. And obviously the most gravest of sin that we find is أَلَا أُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِأَكْبَرِ الْكَبَائِرِ, shall not inform you of the most grievous of sins in the hadith that you find. قُلْنَا بَلَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, it's said in the affirmative, indeed tell us what is the most abominable or the most dangerous sin. قَالَ أَلِشْرَاكُ بِاللَّهِ وَأَقُوقُ الْوَالِدَيْنِ, to commit shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to sever the ties of kinship or one's parents. And any student of the Quran, and in many of us, this is where many of us we fail. You begin to study the Quran in great detail, you find numerous ayat inside the Quran. وَاعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُ بِهِ شَيْئًا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا, worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and after that, associate no partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do what? Show goodness and kindness towards your parents. وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Any student of the Quran can begin to decipher this, pick this up. It's quite sad that we don't find this, unfortunately, of people resembling the Quran, resembling the Sunnah. وَأَخْلَاقُهُمْ سَيِّئَةٌ إِلَىٰ وَالِدَيْهِمْ, you find their behavior, their etiquettes, their manner, their speech towards their parents, very, very questionable, that what they are learning from the teachings of Islam towards their respective parents. وَحَتَّ إِنْ كَانُوا مُشْرِكِينَ, even the parents happen to be disbelievers, happen to be mushrikun, the Quran lays out a manhaj, lays out a methodology of showing goodness to one's parents, as long as they don't command the individual to associate partners or call that person to worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Other than that, you find, إِنَّمَا الطَّاعَةُ فِي الْمَعْرُوفِ, indeed, obedience is in the good things towards anyone's parents. Likewise here, thus we find this hadith, to sever the ties or relationship towards anyone's parents. لَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلُنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَانْزَلْنَا مَعْمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْمِيزَانِ لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِشْرِ, indeed we did send the messenger with بالبينات, the correct evidences, we sent down with them the books, والميزان, the scales of equity and justice, that people may stand upon equity. Here the ulama mentioned al-qishr بمعنى العدل, and he is عدل, equity, justice that we find, and the greatest justice needs to be established upon the earth that the messengers came to establish was what? Worship only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the highest level of justice that needs to be implemented. That's the Quran mentioned, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةِ الرَّسُولَ أَنِ اعْبُدُ اللَّهِ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ, we did send amongst every single nation and ummah a people, that the messenger highlighted to his people or teaching people to worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and stay away from anything which is worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise you find shirk is a form of aib, a form of being derogatory towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you are actually attributing deficiency towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when a person begins to practice or begins to carry out the actions of shirk that we find many people begin to do. So we find that when you commit shirk, you are removing or sending something back to Allah which does not belong to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the deficiency. You're now saying something about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that does not belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that we find inside the Quran also, it mentions to speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that which you have no knowledge regarding. So a person doesn't have any knowledge or doesn't understand something, a person should, and you remain silent. That is also a grave sin as well. that you speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you don't have knowledge any regarding that. So you find that the two basic forms of shirk that you find, shirk akbar, the major shirk, and the minor shirk that you find. Ulama have mentioned that minor shirk leads on to eventually, at times, to what? The major shirk. And obviously we should understand this small principle, because many times we find that Muslims and modern day, I like to use the word modern day fuqaha, begin to try to make this dissection inside society. There is what's known as major sins and minor sins. Okay, there's no doubt about that. But for us as general people, we shouldn't go and encourage people, oh, there's no harm in doing a minor sin, etc. There's no harm in that. No, we should try to be wary about all elements of any form of sin. As the ulama have mentioned, fuqaha mentioned, that there is no la kabira ma'al istighfar. There's no major sin ma'al istighfar. A person carries out any major sin inside their life. They make tawbah, they make istighfar, it's wiped out. وَلَا صَغِيرَ مَعَ الْإِسْتِمْرَارِ There's no minor sin. It no longer remains a minor sin if a person, مَعَ الْإِسْتِمْرَارِ, if a person is repetitious, in nature, repetitious in doing that minor sin, تُصْبِحْ مِنَ الْكَبَائِرِ Eventually becomes classified as a major sin. And just to help us to understand this principle, no one should take this personally. For example, if one حَلْقُ الْلِحْيَةِ shaving of one's beard, okay, it's classified in general as a minor sin. It's an open fisq, an open disobedience, rebelliousness, open disobedience, no doubt about that, shaving one's beard. But if we look at it in the scale of sin, it's a sin, but it's classified as a minor sin. Now, using this principle we mentioned, if a person does it every single day, it eventually becomes what? Classified as a major sin. Because this person is day in and day out, is disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Obviously, Islam, no one should take this person who rests upon the size of one's beard, etc. We're just trying to highlight the principle to help us to understand the point. If somebody tries to box us in a place that your da'wah is only based upon the size of one's beard, a person's thawb, etc. It's far beyond that. But just to help us to understand that we're all trying to help ourselves to become any better Muslims. If some people try to push the element of just minor sins, there's no problem, no haraj, no harm in carrying out a minor sin. Now we're trying to make ourselves wary. And all of us fall into minor sins inside our life, try to better our relationship towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we find that kaba'ir, the major sins that we find, takes a person out the fold of Islam. But as we mentioned, not for us, the common folk, but for the people of knowledge should begin to establish that. So that's the dangerous element. Major shirk will eventually take the individual outside the fold of Islam, whether it be that you find of kadu'a, making dua to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at-taqarrub, coming close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala via oaths or sacrifice that we find, or coming and sacrificing the graves, or sacrificing the name of the jinn or the devil. Obviously it may sound strange, but this does take place, unfortunately, that some people do, Muslims, go and carry out such practices. Wal khawf min al-mawta, or min al-jinn, person is scared from a dead individual, or from the jinn, or from the shayateen, and they can harm me, or they can benefit me, or they can cause me to fall ill, or fall sick, etc. You find this is all major elements of shirk, if a person has this inside their heart. Likewise, you find to hope for to be saved, to be rescued, other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is all something which is very, very dangerous for the individual. As for natural fear that you find, all of us, some of us may be scared of the dark, or wild animals, or scary sounds, or whatever it may be. This is no harm, or a big bear running at you, or gunshot, whatever it may be. This type of fear, la haraj fi dhalik. There's no harm in that. That's not the fear that we're talking about. That element of fear is allowed. But you find that some individuals, they go to an extreme level that they fear the dead people. If you read some of their works, it's quite surprising that they will swear by the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and know that they're lying, okay? That's what they document in some of the works, that if you swear by the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you're lying, that's not bad. But if you swear by the name, don't swear by the name of so-and-so saint or such and such any individual. This person's dead. Don't swear by his name, because now you could face the wrath, you could face the punishment. This shows how bad sometimes our qa'id have dropped to such a level that we begin to fear dead individuals or shrines or whatever it may be. وَيَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَضُرُّهُمْ وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ They begin to worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that which does not benefit them or harm them. وَيَقُولُونَ هَؤُلَاءِ شُفَعَاؤُنَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ They begin to say, these are intermediaries, the ones that will intercede for us besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we as basically Muslims can safely conclude that benefit and harm is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows what we may seem externally seems to be quote unquote harm for us, but there's much fawaid, there's many benefits in that harm which may be seen to be harm to bring that individual back to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second mini element of shirk that we find, as we mentioned, is the minor shirk. This does not take the person, لا يخرجه عن الملة. This does not take you out the fold of Islam. Those other elements, we're going to go through them, inshallah, at a later stage, they could take a person outside the fold of Islam. The minor shirk does not take the individual outside the fold of Islam. And you find there is shirk bin al-zahir, then the apparent shirk the person can do inside their statements. In the alfaz, in the statements, the half bi ghayrillah. Person swears by other than the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does not take you out of the fold of Islam. Okay, this is minor shirk. Making an oath by other name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not take you out of the fold of Islam. But some of us, we begin to label individuals as a person. In the words mentioned in the hadith, man halafa bi ghayrillah faqad kafara wa ashraka. Whoever swears by other name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that individual has committed disbelief or associated partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here, remember, at the end of the day, we have to be very careful in the application of wordings upon people. For example, many ahadith you find, wallahi la yu'min, wallahi la yu'min, wallahi la yu'min. But Allah, that person doesn't believe, that person doesn't believe. Whoever's neighbor is not safe from your harm. Now, does that mean now the person has become a disbeliever? Likewise, you find a hadith, مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Whoever believes in Allah on the last day, فَلْيَقُلْ خَيْرًا أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ. That that person speak well, yani, or remain silent. So if a person doesn't do this, does that mean that person is a disbeliever? Likewise, you find that the person, لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدُكُمْ. One of you doesn't really believe until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. And all of us can fall short of all these ahadith. That wording is what? لَا يُؤْمِنْ. Person doesn't believe. Wallahi, that person doesn't believe. So the application of these ahadith, and in general, the person should not say the person is a disbeliever. It means the person is naqisul iman. The person is deficient inside their belief. The person is deficient. They haven't completed ikmalul iman. They haven't completed the higher level of iman. They're deficient. Likewise, even a person disobeys. You find a person is not a believer when a person is committing zina. Person is not a believer when they're drinking khamr. Now, does that mean when a person doing that action, we now say you're a disbeliever? No, as the ulama, Abu Hurairah, and something going back to him, mentioned that the iman is just lifted up from that individual. A person returns back to the senses, that iman comes back. So it's not for us to apply that a person's committed zina, a person's drunk alcohol, this person is a disbeliever. Or this person, you need, is a mushrik, is what we're trying to highlight. Likewise, you find in the wordings that find if a person may begin to say, any, this is what Allah and the Prophet will or allow. Any, sometimes we hear these words. I remember once an elderly individual saying to me when I was traveling to the Blessed Lands, he said to me that the Prophet ﷺ has called you. He's invited you, so that's why you're going to Medina. So I didn't want to argue too much at that moment, but obviously these are words of shirk. That the Prophet ﷺ has called you, invited you, he's called out to you, so now you're going to make that blessed any journey. So these words, these are words of shirk. The person to say by Allah and the Prophet. This form of attribution, wa wal atf, that we find to have this type of comparison is not allowed. And if that's what you find the Prophet, so some even rebuke the companions or an individual around him who mentioned this is whatever you want, whatever Allah wants and you want. He said, no, this is what only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills. That's it. So a person should be very careful inside their wordings as well, that the wordings don't contain any element, any of shirk. Why? Closing the doors. Remember, Islam is laid upon principles of closing the doors towards vice and towards disobedience. That's what Islam is based upon. What's known in fiqh or in usul fiqh that you find is saddu al-dhari'a wa saddu al-abwab, to close the doors. Close the doors of vices or the opening of the door that people begin to do whatever they want to do. So that's why many of the practices, why the ulama, the scholars, or the people of authority began to clamp down upon them, was it will eventually lead on to what? Other practices. Lead on to even mundane things like education, etc. Working is all something which is permissible. But if the end result becomes something which in general becomes something which is evil or full of munkarat and something which is unacceptable, then Islam says apply those rules and regulations where? In the beginning. Not like the society around us that let people do what they want to do, and when the sin is flourishing inside society, then come back and try to discover where did we get it wrong? What did we do wrong to allow this to get to right from the beginning before it begins to flourish or become something which is indeed uncontrollable? Likewise, we find any min al-af'al, the actions of minor shirk that we find is a person wearing a ring or having some string to protect them from some evil, etc. This is an element of minor shirk, wearing rings and amulets and threads, etc. And a person thinks it gives me bad luck or keeps me away from the evil eye, whatever it may be. It's minor shirk. But if the person begins to have a belief of total reliance that this action ring and it brings me benefit or brings me harm, then this enters into what now? Into major shirk. So the person is generally aware of something, thinking that it's some form of whatever it may be, good luck, charm or whatever. We're not saying it's allowed, but there's an element of minor shirk. But now if the person begins to rely upon that, and you find some Muslims are like that, unfortunately, they may forget Ayatul Kursi in their top pocket and say, that's why this bad luck happened to me today, or I forgot to wear the copper thread or the copper whatever maybe I was wearing today, etc. So people quickly, unfortunately, Muslims, you don't be surprised. You say, because I left that at home, I didn't do that today, or I didn't wear that today, I didn't carry in my pocket, so this bad luck, or this has happened to me. And you can read through the superstitious beliefs of what non-Muslims have that eventually fall into us wearing of the rabbit's foot, etc., and putting a horse's shoe outside your door, and don't spill salt inside the house, and don't open the umbrella, etc., that we find. So we find that anything which leads to shirk needs to be uprooted, needs to be stopped. That's what we find in the statement of the Arabs, a woman committed adultery to build a masjid. So she committed adultery to take the money, and to the end does not justify the means, okay? That's why today we've got some Muslim, unfortunately, some Muslim drug dealers amongst us now, who say that we serve drugs, we sell drugs to help Islam. We take that money and we help the people. We help the Mujahideen or we help other individuals. What is this? So this proverb falls upon that woman who committed adultery to build a masjid. So the end does not justify the means, okay? Anything which is haram does not allow that. Now you're trying to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can come through a haram means to come taqarruban ila Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If that concept doesn't exist inside Islam, the niyyah has to be good, and it must be followed by good deeds. Okay, if you have a good, sound intention, you need to do sound, good deeds to get to that end of that intention. You cannot have some of these people say we have a good intention, but the means that they follow is something which is corrupt or something which is not accurate. We find shirk inside the heart, and we find nobody knows, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. So many people may gather sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but some people may have an intent of the dunya. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that what is really in the hearts of the individual. But obviously why the study of Tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the person is able to remove that. Thus we find that the most fearful element of shirk that the Prophet was worried upon us, أَخَافُ مَا أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ, what I fear for you the most is what? Is the hidden shirk, الرِّيَا, السُمْعَ, العُجُب, being startled, being marveled, doing things for praising of people, to be mentioned by people, etc. That's what we find the first three people judged in the day judgment will be those individuals who had an incorrect intention. So this is the minor shirk which can be very detrimental for the individual, that we all need to polish up upon that. That's what many of the fuqaha they mentioned. It's like you go and study tafsir, you study hadith, you study usul. You need someone in the zawiyah, somebody in the pillars to teach you what? About the ikhlas, about intention, about purifying that throughout your life, every single moment. That's what many ulama fuqaha they wrote and they mentioned. The most difficult thing that I found inside my life is to focus upon that. And if I can safely conclude that a few minutes of sincerity I've found that in my life, I can say I'm a successful individual, what they mentioned. It's like many of their works. So a person always needs to be struggling to remove that from their life. Thus you find, فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُوا لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. Whoever hopes to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let that individual sincerely worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, associate no partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that worship. So you find that this hidden shirk begins to creep up upon the individual. just like a black ant on a black rock on a moonless night, sneaks up to the individual, takes any the mind and intention you need away. So whether it be visual action that we find, and whether it be qira'at to the Qur'an, any beautifying their voice and the reading of the Qur'an, extending their prayers. So a person can make that mizan themselves, that in secrecy, do I normally extend my prayers, make my sujood, make my ruku like this? Do I focus upon the Qur'an any like this? Do I do these actions like this? So, and one way to counteract this element of hidden shirk is in secrecy. That if a person excels in trying to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in secrecy, then it strengthens any the iman of the individual. And as a side from many ulama tazkir, that we need to mention strange or wonderful words, that you find that if a person is doing an action of ibadah, and then the person begins to think that they're doing, that people are watching them, then should a person leave that ibadah? Some of the ulama go to the view that is even more greater shirk now, because now you're leaving the worship. You need to fight it off. Fight that element within your heart to purify your heart and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, you find that people do certain things, the ajdil mal, whether it be even you find any much debate begins to take place of teaching Islamic sciences, etc., whether the imam of the masjid should take a ratib, take a salary, person reads Quran, many, you find any discussions take place from this. And there's an element of truth, because sometimes it can begin to make that individual make the intention become possibly something else. Or make the person deviate in a manner at times of not being able to speak the truth as well. When a person is on a salary or is controlled and is restricted, the person is not able to express themselves, the right teaching from the Quran and the Sunnah. So a person should be wary of that. Jahid lil mal, person makes jihad, li shuhra, to be famous, for wealth, for the booty, etc., to be known as a brave individual. So these are elements a person needs to fight inside throughout their life. Likewise, you find mentions on the hadith, Isa Abdul Dinar. Wretched is the one who worships the dinar, who worships the pound, who worships the dollar, who worships al-khamisa, who worships clothing, who worships khamila, who worships land. This person, if he's given, he's happy. If he's not given, he becomes wretched, he becomes upset. So we as basic Muslims need to begin to place this in our lives. That if we're given something, do we become happy about that? If we're not given something, do we become unhappy about that? That's we need to weigh ourselves up. So that's the Muslims really fight and struggle within their heart and in their mind. That a person is seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they're given or not given, their ajr lies with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you find that this element of Ibn Qayyim mentioned, the shirk is like an ocean that has no end. That's what Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah mentioned, that shirk al-khafi is like an ocean which has really no end. That a person really needs to focus upon this. So good action, a good intention does not make a bad action become good, is the saying of the Nabi Mas'ud. So if a person has a good intention, it does not make a bad action become something which is acceptable. The person needs to have a good intention and a good unique action as well. So we find in conclusion, a few things that we can summarize upon for today, inshallah. Shirk, akbar, takes you out the fold of Islam. Okay, so it takes you out the fold of Islam in general. As for the minor shirk, it does not take you out the fold of Islam. Like we find that a person who commits the major shirk will enter into hellfire for eternity. As you find inside Surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, إِنَّوْ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَأْوَاهُنَا وَمَا لِلْظَالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنْصَارٍ. Whoever dies upon the major shirk, that individual, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it haram for that individual to ever enter into paradise. As a person who commits minor shirk, then that person will not remain in paradise forever, in hellfire forever. That person will eventually come out and enter into paradise. Likewise, if one shirk akbar cancels all actions, makes your ibadah, your worship become null and void. That's what we're trying to highlight. It's very, very important that we know our family members who are carrying out these actions, we need to drill it in them and instill this within them, that your actions can become null and void. As for minor shirk, you find that action which may have that element of showing off, that action can be something which is rejected. Fourthly, as we mentioned, the person's blood and property becomes halal. As for the person commits minor shirk, nothing can be taken away from that individual. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq and the ability to begin to really go back and do our own reading, our own study, to begin to understand. It is more any understanding of what is shirk, and inshallah, hopefully, next we look at any and kufr, and disbelief, its various forms and formats, etc. Inshallah. If there's any comments or correction, take a few minutes with them. If not, we'll stop there, inshallah. Maybe next week I should start asking a question there, Chairman. Huh? At the end of the day, you should try to make notes where we listen to in your own time, inshallah. And obviously, it will benefit you. Whatever you write and describe, it benefits you. And even in a later stage, when I took these notes, these were made, I think, maybe 2005. And the Sheikh will explain to them, inshallah. So obviously, whatever you write down, you find it will benefit, then you really will go back, inshallah, and for the rest of your life, inshallah.
As a clarification and a summary, can you just give a summary of the subject of a tawheed? We spent some time explaining the kufr of shirk. Just as a summary, you may have done before, but just as a summary, what is a tawheed?
Yeah, as you mentioned that tawheed, and it goes back, and you mentioned when I go back, it goes back to the root verb of the noun of one. Tawheed is one of singling out, any wahidun, any making, singling out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for worship. As you mentioned, the ayah from Surah Al-Dhariyat, 51st chapter, verse number 56, that the whole essence of creation of the human being is to single out and to worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the way of all of the anbiya. That recognition and the da'wah is what we as Muslims should be instilling within ourselves and to the wider community around us. Many people say, what are ways that we can really attract people towards al-Islam? There may be many weird and wonderful ways that we find, I mean, that your imagination exists now. People want to attract people towards al-Islam. But look at the methodology of the Quran. Look at the methodology of the Prophet Muhammad SAW. He is calling people to that oneness. That will attract people, the recognition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the obedience and the servitude towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will attract individuals to do what? When the heart becomes full of love towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, becomes full of hope, becomes full of fear as well, that will instill within the individual to abstain from many of the vices and the sins that we're trying to tell them to stay away from. So, for example, sometimes in our zeal of that, we might meet a young individual and say, look, music is haram or smoking is haram. It may benefit the individual, and even for a small amount of time. But if the person doesn't recognize, doesn't know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, doesn't understand, so the person could go back after a short while, just out of fear, out of respect for you, whatever it may be, and return back to those actions. So you need to instill, I'm not saying we shouldn't stop that munkar, I'm not saying we shouldn't highlight that whenever we have the opportunity and ability, but we need to instill that the recognition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that will create any total obedience for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The person in sir, wal alaniya, in hidden, or in open, or in ghaybi, or shahada, in the apparent, or the unseen, wherever that person is focusing upon worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what we start to highlight, as Sheikh Muhammad Salih al-Uthaymeen rahmatullahi mentioned. Many of you works on Aqeedah, we read his works in great detail. He always sends home the message that Aqeedah is not just a technical element. It's the application that begins to develop inside your life. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. Yes, there's a technical academic side of how people begin to deviate about what to attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ayn Allah, where is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, etc. All that exists, there's no doubt. But what is the crux of the ayah? What is the real hidden meaning that we can begin to develop? We develop this and we can begin to deliver this to the masses. It makes masses of people, makes it easier to come to the right tawheed. If you come from that angle, that you're trying to soften their heart towards the belief and the recognition towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obedience towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it will begin to have that powerful impact upon them. And you can see the impact of Ahlul Tawheed, the people of Tawheed, and the words of Tawheed, how it's disseminated, how it's delivered across people, and it's changed nations, it's changed people. So likewise, you find Mu'adh ibn Jabal, you find that the first thing that you come to the people is to teach them about the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah, we have a prime many opportunity around us to this day to deliver the message of oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the people around us, and likewise to our own any people, any as well. Allah Alam, that's what comes to our mind at this moment, inshaAllah.
Sheikh, so you mentioned about iman and disiman. So would you say that iman, our iman is one level, but the nur of it is high and low, or the actual iman is high and low, and it varies?
Maybe in general that we know in general that iman yazidu bil ta'ati wa yanqus bil ma'asiyah. Iman in general, Ahlul Sunnah, it goes up by obedience and it comes down by disobedience. A person can physically even feel that in their life, can't they? You can find what's known as halawatul iman, the outside the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or it's the month of Ramadan, you find the feeling of compassion, of mercy, a good feeling of coming towards good deeds, etc. Likewise, a person disobeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, person feels that inside their heart, feels the upset, feels any etc. down or whatever it may be. So we as Ahlul Sunnah, we conclude that iman, it goes up and it goes down. And no one has a complete total iman. The total iman was only given to the Prophet Muhammad who had that total level of iman that he had. As for the rest of us, our iman, it fluctuates from one moment to another moment. Allah Akbar. Inshallah. We'll stop there, inshallah. Inshallah. We'll carry on, inshallah, next week.